Hey everybody, this is Michael again, and welcome back to my channel here on YouTube. Well guys, I thought that it was a good time for another DVD and Blu-ray update. Taking a break from the Friday the 13th films, even though I have seen Part 3. That's the one in 3D. For you guys that may not have known that, 3D way back then, it wasn't oversaturated back then, but according to the special features on the Blu-ray disc, they said that 3D was starting to return to be a fad. And I'm, for the life of me, I can't think of any other 3D films back in those days other than a movie called Space Hunter: Adventures in the Forbidden Zone. But I don't know. But anyway, why was I even talking about that? But anyway, taking a break from the Friday the 13th reviews and the Stephen King reviews. Now, they will return, guys. This is just a little bit of a video interlude here where I'm going to do another video. And it's about time to have a DVD and Blu-ray update because I've had these films sitting on my shelf upstairs. And I was actually... Ooh, you saw the names. Damn you. No. But I was actually... planning on doing a DVD Blu-ray update, but I didn't have enough films that would actually allow for an update, at least in my opinion anyway, so I decided to give it a wait until I got films sitting up there. Now I got, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 different films. Didn't know I could count that high, did you? But anyway, since this is going to be a little DVD update and you guys are going to get into my mind for a little while, I thought I'd add an Old Glory to the mix. What's funny about Old Glory, guys, is that, you know, it almost, you know, it's an aluminum can. And it almost looks a little bit like a beer can. So, you know, when I'm at work, and this is a true story, guys, when I'm at work, you know, walking from here to there, Heathrow to Heathrow, residents, you know, always constantly seeing me taking a drink and all this, reported me to the senior management staff. Oh, you know, you've got an employee there that keeps drinking all the time. He's drinking on the job, as in drinking alcohol. And of course, there's no alcohol in Old Glory, but yeah, you know, calls me to the office. Hey, we've got a complaint against you. People are saying that you're actually drinking on the job. Is that true? I'm like, well, yeah, it is. It is true. I have been drinking. What do you drink? Old Glory. Come on, man. Yeah, people are always running their mouths. You know, if you don't see for yourself, if you don't have proof of what someone's drinking, don't say anything. Some things are better left unsaid. But anyway, yes, we are going to get to the DVD and Blu-ray update eventually. But first, I thought I would have a Twix. Do any of you guys out there like Twix? I love peanut butter flavored Twix. Some people will make videos and say, hey, I've been poked by so-and-so to tell 5 different facts about myself. Well, you've already learned 2 facts about me, guys. I like Old Glory and Twix. Love to eat them together. Well, I eat one and drink the other. But anyway, thought I would say, guys, you know, I went to the mall a week ago, and, you know, I never really just go to the mall for myself. Don't eat with your mouth full. I can still hear my grandmother now. But anyway, she would be appalled. But anyway, I went to the mall. You know, I go to the mall with my better half. You know, I don't really ever just want to go to the mall because when I used to go to the malls, guys, malls were fun. I mean, you had video game arcades in the mall, which were a blast. If you don't know what a video arcade is, go watch some of the 80s films and you'll see several. But there was one in particular at a mall, actually two malls I used to go to when I was a kid. One was called the Gold Mine, which was not too big a mall. I mean, not too big a game room, but really some nice game. They had up-to-date games. And then there was one called Le Mans in a place called Crossroads Malls when I was a kid. And that sucker was huge. There were so many games in there. It's just a lot of fun. And then, of course, we got video games at home. We got the Super NES, the NES, PlayStation, and all that, which pretty much spelled the end of arcades. And speaking of that, there was also one called Malibu that actually had these race cars that you could go drive on the outside in this big field. That was actually a nice track, a really nice track. And then they had arcade games inside, and that was a lot of fun. What's sad though, guys, is you rarely see those in malls anymore. They're pretty much gone. And another thing about the malls that I used to like was the bookstores. Used to love to go in the bookstores. Used to love to glance through the magazines. They had Hustler, Penthouse, Playboy, Players, and I'm just lying my ass off. They didn't have any of those magazines, guys. They only had, you know, regular magazines. But I used to love to go and browse the sci-fi magazines at the bookstore and look at some of the novels and get so excited about a new Star Trek novel, I mean, or a new Star Trek photo novel, technical manual, all these specialty books. I mean, you just... B. Dalton Booksellers and Walden Books. Walden's was my favorite. But man, malls have changed so much with the advent of the digital age, the internet, digital books you can read. You know, it just killed the bookstores. No, I'm not going to Barnes & Noble, but unfortunately that's the closest thing. Even though they use coffee to lure you in, guys, you know. If you want to pay $5 for some coffee. But anyway, so, you know, the mall is just a, you know, some of you might be saying, why is he telling us this? But the mall is just a place that just changed so much radically with the stores that are not there anymore that I just have no desire in a mall. As a matter of fact, I dread going to the mall. I get bored in the mall because it's just not what it's used to. Oh, you're hanging on to the past. Yeah. You definitely could say that, guys. And another thing. Some of you won't know this, but do you miss the days of actually going to a video store? Actually being able to... You know, the video stores to me were just so much fun. Stores like Blockbuster, Hollywood Video, where you could just go in, you know, look at all the videos, they have them half priced and all this stuff. And you could, it was more like an experience to me, just going to the video store. It was just a lot of fun. I remember those days vividly. And, I mean, now we have, like, a few video stores, Family Video, some of the ma and pop stores, but all the big chains are gone, and it's terrible. You know, then we got Redbox that pretty much wiped out Blockbuster. All the movies online and everything. It's just... that's another thing that I just, you know, I really, really miss video stores. I really miss them. And you came here for a DVD and Blu-ray update. We are going to get to that. Gotta wipe my hand. Okay. Actually, these films are some that I got from the pawn shop and Walmart, and a couple from Amazon.com. And don't be fooled, guys. I know behind me you see like three big shelves of films, and a lot of people would be like, wow, man, you got so many movies, you should open up your own video store. Hmm. Maybe one day. How many copies do you have? I only got one of that movie. I've got another one checked out. I'm lying. But anyway, I've actually got another rack that would not fit here. A full-size rack with movies enough to fill more than that rack. But we didn't have the space to move it in, so I've got another rack of my films that are not here. So you're not seeing the extent of my collection. As a matter of fact, I don't even know what I'm going to do with these DVDs and Blu-rays that I have now, because as you can see, every shelf is full. I guess I'll just have to start setting them on the top between the gaps. Ice maker. But anyway, the first film is one that actually stars Adrian Brody and Keira Knightley. And this is a film that I've never seen. I have heard of the movie, but I was intrigued not only by the cover, but by the story. And basically, Adrian Brody plays a Gulf War veteran back in 1993. And he wakes up in a straitjacket, has no memory of how he got there or who he is. And he's being experimented on, and he wakes up in 2007. He's experiencing some kind of time travel through the experiments. And I just thought it sounded like a really, really interesting film. Now, of course, when I show the movie, many of you might have already seen it. Don't tell me what it's about or anything other than what I said, but what did you think about this movie? This is The Jacket. And I have not seen this, guys, and it's definitely sounding really, really interesting. But I'll have to give it a look. Sounds really, really good. Hmm. Does it have a date by when this came out? It just says color 103 minutes. Remember the good old days when you could actually look at a DVD on the back and it'd say like color 103 minutes, 1993. They don't even put the release date on this thing, which is weird. But it does look pretty damn interesting. Next, we have another one, guys, that I have not seen. I had not seen this film, but I was struck by the cover. I liked the cover, and that prompted me to read the synopsis, and I liked what the film was saying, and I thought it sounded really, really interesting. It says, beyond reality, beyond fear, beyond your imagination. And this is Franklin. And, you know, at first I thought it was about that turtle, Franklin, but apparently it's not about the turtle. It's about some other character. Never seen the movie. Any of you guys seen this movie? If so, thumbs up or thumbs down. Let me know what you thought. Here's the back of it, guys. Looks pretty interesting to me. And as a matter of fact, on the back it says, a breath of fresh air, the most impressive, daring feature from a first-time writer, director I've seen in some times. Well, you know, I've heard that before, guys. You know, when I made my fan film, Starship Valiant, you know, people were saying, you know, the most impressive first-time writer, director I've seen in a long time. The executive producer is just great, you know. I'm just pulling your legs. Nobody said that. But yeah, this sounds good. It also says clever and unexpected. Impressive stuff. Of course, the people that are saying this are people I never heard of, but, you know, I mean, you never know. Franklin, guys, definitely going to check out Franklin. Okay, next we have a film starring Dennis Quaid and Sharon Stone. As a matter of fact, I like both these actors, guys. It's kind of sad that Sharon Stone hasn't really been in a hit film since, you know, back in her 80s and early 90s glory days. I remember when Sharon Stone was considered one of the hottest actresses around. And when she was younger, take for instance when she was in Total Recall with Arnold Schwarzenegger, the original film, she was pretty doggone hot. She was a hot actress. And even up to Basic Instinct, where she was just, you know, knockout. I don't know, guys. She's hasn't aged really, really well, in my opinion. But, you know, we all get old and we all change, so we'll just say time has been unkind to her. But I mean, you know, it just depends. Sometimes she does look hot, sometimes she doesn't. But when she was younger, she was just hot all the time. But anyway, this is a film that I thought, you know, was sound like a good thriller. And I bought this for my better half because I figured she would like it. But you know, I bought it for her, but it's still going in my collection. But anyway, you ever do that, guys? You know, your wife or girlfriend, you buy a movie and you say, "Hey, I bought this movie for you," and you're thinking, "Yeah, it's going on my shelf and my movies." But anyway, and I'm running out of time, guys, almost. But here we have Coal Creek Manor, Sharon Stone and Dennis Quaid. Sounds like a very interesting film. If any of you saw this movie, if you have, let me know. A terrific thriller. Okay, guys. This is actually one that I saw in the theater years and years ago, and I'm trying to just guess when this film came out. I think it was 19... Yes, and I am looking at the front cover. I believe it was 1985. But this is another Stephen King adaptation. And I remember when I saw it in the theater, and I don't want to say too much about it because if I review it, which I probably will, I don't want to ruin the experience, ruin the material that I'll say for the review. But anyway, this is Stephen King's Silver Bullet. And I did see this in the theater, and I did enjoy it way back when. I thought it was a good film, very, very entertaining. And maybe just a little bit creepy in the eyes of a young teenager. But let's see when this came out. I think it was 85. Yeah, 85, color, 94 minutes, rated R. Now, see what I'm saying, guys? They tell you something about the movie, whereas the jacket, it just says color, 103 minutes. Okay. Let's see what Coal Creek Manor says. Color, digitally mastered, 119 minutes. It don't say what year either. Franklin, color, 98 minutes. What is the deal with that? Whereas Silver Bullet says 1985, color, 94 minutes, rated R. Weird. Just weird. Why did it leave that out? But I liked Silver Bullet when I saw it in the theaters, guys. And it's definitely going to be like watching it all over again. And hopefully I will still enjoy the film. I'll have to give you guys my thoughts on it. Next, guys, we have a sitcom. This is the complete third season. I've got the first and second season. As a matter of fact, here is the first and second season. I may have shown this during another DVD or Blu-ray update, but this is The Jeffersons, season 1 and 2. Absolutely love this show, guys. I thought it's I think it's a very, very funny show. I think it's topical. I think it discusses things that need to be discussed. sometimes it's pretty raw with what the title character, George Jefferson, here says. And this was a show that was, I believe, Norman Lear had to help in making this film or this series. As a matter of fact, I don't say anything about Norman Lear on there. Let's see. No, it doesn't say anything about Norman Lear on here, but Norman Lear, if I am correct, guys, was a producer and creator who had a hand in some of the most popular pop cultural shows around. And many of you may not, if you're really, really young, you probably never heard, even, you know, The Jeffersons, you probably never even heard of this show. But Norman Lear not only created shows like The Jeffersons. As a matter of fact, here's the back of this, guys. He not only created shows like The Jeffersons, but he tended to make shows that were pretty... he used humor to discuss topical subjects. And all his shows had compelling characters. And they featured, to me, even though they were sitcoms and were comical... The subject matter was just downright in your face, realistic things that people think and say that you just don't hear a lot of people saying. At least if you're not a member of the. We won't go there. But anyway, a great series that he helped to create, guys. And one of his most successful television series would be Sanford and Son. And what's kind of funny, guys, you know, it makes me think about a coworker who, you know, one day we were working together, and I mentioned a joke that Red Fox, and this is Red Fox here, guys, he's long since passed away, a brilliant comedian, just brilliant. And his absolute most brilliant work is on this television show. But I had mentioned the joke from Sanford and Son, and he's like, Sanford and Son? What's Sanford and Son? And he had no clue what Sanford and Son was. And then I mentioned another show. Do you know about Archie Bunker, All in the Family? Never heard of the show, never seen any of it. And, I mean, and these were hugely popular shows. And it just kind of blew my mind that people don't know who Archie Bunker is, All in the Family, Sanford and Son, Starsky and Hutch, George Jefferson. But I said, man, if you don't know who Sanford and Son is, you need to watch that show, man. That is a kick-ass funny show, even today. And he's like, nah, I probably won't ever watch it. And I'm thinking, God, you just don't know what you're missing to not watch shows like this. This is just classic comedy. One of the all-time, in my humble opinion, funniest sitcoms ever. Well, I guess he'll just have to miss out. I kind of feel sorry for folks that don't give these older shows a chance, because they're just totally hilarious. And one thing about them now is that they put things on those shows that you would never see done in current day television. Never. Okay, we were on the subject of the Jeffersons, guys, but that's season 1 and 2, and I finally got the Jeffersons season 3. And there's the front cover of his show, guys. Some of the characters down there. And what's kind of distressing about season 3, guys, when these were made, they were put out by Sony Home Video. And Sony got up to, I believe, season 6 of these releases. And I think the show lasted 11 seasons, but Sony quit at season 7. And then Mill Creek took over and got the license of the show, and they put this season 1 and 2 combo here together. This is not the original Sony release. But anyway, so they released it. And then, oddly enough, Mill Creek did not finish the series either. They only did season 1 and 2. Dumbasses. And Sony only went up to season 6. So they have not completed these set yet, guys. And as a matter of fact, now the license has gone to Shout Factory, who, you know, bless their hearts, have did a complete show in a box set of the series for, I think, a total of $140. But my point is, you know, I've collected the first 3 seasons of this show in individual sets, and I've got the next 3 seasons ordered on their way. And then they quit. And of course, I found this out later. So to get the remaining seasons, I have to buy Shout Factory's complete release of the show. And that's just BS. You know, I know it's just totally being ridiculous in my thoughts here, guys. But if these guys are going to get this license and start releasing these series, it is totally, totally irresponsible to not finish this shit out. If you have fans collecting this shit, supporting your company, supporting your releases, then you're gonna leave them in the dirt and not even finish. That is the most bullshit I have ever heard. And I don't wanna hear the company say, well, they wasn't selling that well. Who gives a shit? Lose money. You have a responsibility, in my opinion, to finish this stuff, because you started it. You got these people buying these things, supporting you, spending their hard-earned cash, and then you're just going to leave them hanging. Well, we're not going to complete the series because sales on it were unexpectedly low, but I hear Shout Factory has combined the entire series into one set, and you can buy it, shell out another $150. It's just total irresponsible, guys. And it should not be allowed. These companies, you know, the God, and they just, I don't see how these companies have any shit left, because, you know, they're constantly shitting on the fans. And it's just, just totally irresponsible, and it's just morally wrong. And you know, I don't know, guys. So I don't know what I'm gonna do about the rest of the seasons. Maybe, you know, I'll stumble across somebody selling season 7, 8, 9, and 10 along with 11 on eBay or something. So I don't know, but I do know that I love the series, and I do very, very badly want to get the rest of the seasons, but I do not want to shell out the money for a complete set now. But anyway, the Jeffersons, guys, it came out in 1975, ended in 1985, and so maybe it lasted for 10 seasons. Let's see what the back says here. It don't say, but this collection has 24 episodes on it, guys, and I'll show you the outside of the collection. There we go. And show it a little bit closer. Of course, I can't see. Really, really nice sets put out by Sony, guys. And no doubt, Shout Factory set is probably pretty nice, too. But then here's the inside. And the Shout Factory set even has extras, guys. These don't have any extras that I've seen so far. So that kind of sucks, too. But here's the inside of it. Really, really nice set, guys. And I got this, you know, used in very good shape. And it's really, really nice shape. So I don't know what I'm going to do about the rest of the collection, guys, because I definitely don't know what I'm going to do. Okay. Moving on up, guys. We have, some of you will get that joke. We have a movie 6 set. This was also put out by Mill Creek. Fucking Mill Rats. They didn't even finish the collection. But anyway, Mill Creek, for the most part, guys, they do some decent releases. They're budget home video releases, but at the same time, they do a good job. You know, picture clarity and all that is pretty good for the most part. I haven't seen a release from them that they actually restored a film, but I mean, that's not saying that they might not have done it. But this is a 6 film set, guys, featuring the Three Stooges, and you get the films The Three Stooges Go Around the World in a Daze, Rockin' in the Rockies, The Outlaws Is Coming, The Three Stooges Meet Hercules, Time Out for Rhythm, and Have Rocket Will Travel. But there we go, guys. These are all collected in a tin. And this actually came from Walmart, guys. If you're wanting to collect these films, they only cost me like $7 and some change to get. But here's the back of it. But, you know, I have the Three Stooges complete short collection, and I just thought this would be a nice addition to that collection. This would be really, really nice with that collection. And many of these films I have never seen. As a matter of fact, the only one I have seen is Have Rocket Will Travel. So out of the 6 films, I still got 5 to watch. And the big thing about these films, and Stooge fans will know, is that instead of Curly, who had passed away long before these films were made, we have Joe DiRita. And I've never really been a fan of Joe DiRita, guys. I mean, I think he's okay. I think I might have liked him more than I like Joe Besser, who, you know, after Curly passed away, we got Shemp, whom I love. I love Shemp to death. I think Shemp is so funny and definitely the underrated Stooge. But he is just hilarious to me. And then we got Joe Besser, who was such a crybaby character that I just, you know, just didn't really care for him too much. And then after reading how hard and difficult it was to work with the guy, it just made me kind of say, wow, you know, he's just there to get a paycheck. But anyway, then we had Curly Joe. And of course, this is Curly Joe here. And Curly Joe is kind of a humble, kind of a meek character, totally opposite of Curly. And as a matter of fact, by the time these films were made, the Three Stooges didn't really concentrate too much on slapstick and physical humor anymore. They were up in age. I think they were probably in their, maybe even late 50s or early 60s. But So all the slapstick, all the comic timing that they did was pretty much gone. And then, you know, the world had changed. All that violent slapstick and all that was, you know, they were geared, these films were geared towards children. Apparently they made 6 films, so they were a success. The shorts started to be shown on television, and their old theatrical shorts were really, really popular. And this kind of created a resurgence of these phenomenal characters, and they started making these films. But the sad fact of the matter is that, you know, the Three Stooges made their shorts, and then of course they closed down when shorts were no longer popular in the older films. And then when they started showing them to television, they actually made a deal with the television producers and sold the entire library, or licensed the entire library to television. What's kind of sad is that they didn't even tell any of the original actors. They didn't cut them any money for using their material. There wasn't any residuals or anything like that. So all the hard work that they had done, and it's popular, and they got really, really popular on television, the original Three Stooges did not get one puny cent. And that was just wrong, man. Just totally wrong. So, you know, you hear all these stories, guys. You know, you might like a show on television, but behind the scenes, sometimes it's just hell. And, you know, I've shown my Jeffersons Season 3 collection. One thing about that show, guys, is that as popular as it was, and it was always very, very popular, very popular show on television, Sherman Hemsley, who plays George Jefferson, this guy here, when they canceled the show, they didn't even give him a formal notification. Matter of fact, he actually, I think he read about it. Or he either read about it or he saw it on television. He wasn't contacted by the studios or anything. But when he heard it, he called the studio and said, "Hey, what's going on? I read this thing. Yeah, we're canceling the show." And it's just amazing to me how these producers treat their bread and butter. I mean, it's like when they don't want something, they just throw it away. And it's really disheartening. It's really disheartening when you love a show, you love the actors, kind people, and you see that they're just treated so badly. And that's just wrong. One of the things about the Three Stooges, you know, I had watched the Three Stooges as a kid, and they were just part, you know, part of my childhood, a part of my life. I just love the shows, love the shorts. And what's funny about them is that even to this day, these shorts, which are just so, so old, I can watch these things and they're guaranteed to make me laugh. Even today, even now, I watch the Three Stooges, and it's just the power, the charisma, the charm of these actors to, you know, create humor. It's just totally, I'm just trying to laugh just thinking about some of the skits, but totally hilarious. And I have a special fondness for Mo Howard, who was actually more or less the leader of the Three Stooges behind the scenes. He actually, you know, negotiated their contracts and just, you know, pretty much ran everything. And many of you may not know, but Curly Howard is Moe's brother, the character of Curly. And Shemp, that was also Moe's brother. Now, Larry Fine, who played Larry, of course, was not a family member, but he was always like a brother to Moe because they had worked together for so long and he was treated like a family member. But I remember I gained an all different respect, an endearing respect for Mo Howard, as I was reading, I think it's a book called Mo Howard and the Three Stooges, and Mo was talking about how they were performing in this town when they were doing vaudeville. I bought a bill too, a $2 bill. But anyway, they were going to this town to perform, and Mo was walking up the sidewalk. And this older black gentleman, probably in the 60s, was walking toward him. So when they met on the sidewalk, Mo got off the sidewalk So if the old guy could pass by, I mean, this is way back in the 30s, guys. You know, it was pretty, you know, we got a lot of prejudice today, guys. You know, if anything, prejudice is still alive and well. A lot of people don't say things, but a lot of things have definitely bought out racism. And, you know, that's sad. You know, 2014, and we human beings can't get along because of the color of our skin. But anyway, so Mo got off the sidewalk, and he let the old guy walk by, and the old guy stopped, and he was like, you know, what are you doing? You're not from around here, are you? And Mo was like, you know, flabbergasted. What are you talking about? I'm getting off the sidewalk, so, you know, respectful, letting the old person pass. I want you to pass by. I'm getting out of your way. And the old guy more or less told him, you know, you're not from around here. You know, you don't do that. You don't do that. I'm supposed to get off the sidewalk. When I see a white person coming, I'm supposed to get off the sidewalk, not you. And the old guy was just as flabbergasted as Mo to actually see a white person get off the sidewalk so that he could pass. And Mo was like, well, what are you talking about? I don't understand. I've never heard anything like this. What are you talking about? This is wrong. That I'm not supposed to let you pass. And the old guy just pretty much said, well, you know, you better be careful here. Watch your step. And then he walked away. And then when Mo got to the theater where they were going to be performing, the producer at the theater told him, and a lot of this, guys, I'm kind of catchphrasing because it's been a long time since I read this, but the producer told him, well, you know, we don't allow, something came up to where he told Mo Howard that we don't allow blacks in here, you know, blacks can't watch the show. And Mo was just like caught off guard. He was like, what are you talking about? Our shows are for everyone to enjoy. And the head at the theater said, no, we don't allow blacks in here. There's not going to be any blacks in this theater. They can't watch this. They're not allowed. And he was kind of like looking at Mo like, what the hell? You should know this stuff. You're white. But anyway, do you know that Mo Howard pulled everything out of that town? He would not perform there. He told the producer of that show, you know, if this theater isn't good enough for black folks, then it's not good enough for me. And he just, you know, would not perform. And he said he never went back to that town again. And I got to tell you guys, it's a lot of admiration there to see. And, you know, there are plenty good people, and I don't like using labels at all. I don't like saying, oh, he's a good white person. Or if someone comes in and acts crazy and someone says, hey, this black lady came in, I don't like using labels. I just say this person, this female, this woman. So I don't use labels. But I gained a new respect for Mo Howard in that story simply because of the time period he lived in, the racist things that were going on in the 30s. And, you know, there's still plenty of things that need to be done to change views today. But having him have the foresight to say, no, I'm not going to be this way just because everybody else is, I'm not going to perform here, that just spoke volumes of this man. And I just have a undying respect for him. He's just someone I would have loved to have met. But anyway, yes, this is a DVD and Blu-ray update, and I'm your host, Michael King. Coming up next, Mo Howard and the Three Stooges. I'm kidding, guys. I mean, I'm not racist at all, guys. I mean, there's plenty of dumb fucks in every race, I gotta tell you. I experience one every day on YouTube. Keyboard warriors. But anyway, the next film is a specialty film. I got this from Walmart. Another thing about me, guys, is that I love, absolutely love dinosaur documentaries. Love them to death. Never get enough of them. And the BBC makes the absolute best dinosaur documentaries ever. As a matter of fact, they make the best documentaries ever. And my favorite documentary host is probably, not even probably, it's David Attenborough. I just love David Attenborough. And all of you have probably seen him. He's been on television for, I can remember him when I was a kid, he was on television, along with Jacques Cousteau. And David Attenborough was always my favorite. I just loved his nature shows. They were just filmed so well, and he just had so much passion and love for what he was doing. The man loves animals. Still around. He's gotten on up in age now, but he's still doing what he loves to do. And, oh, I was talking about this BBC documentary, but this is Predator Dinosaur. That's a really, really nice cover there, guys. I like that cover. CGI, but the BBC dinosaur documentaries are pretty doggone great, guys. I mean, they make some really good documentaries. And one of these days, I have to show you all my dinosaur film collection. One thing about dinosaur documentaries is that they're learning so much every day about these ancient creatures that, you know, the facts just change so much. So if you have an older DVD, the ones later on in your collection are like proven that the old ones were wrong. It's almost like, why do I even keep this? It's nowhere near accurate, but I keep them anyway. Love dinosaur documentaries. All I want for Christmas is a dinosaur documentary and a PlayStation 4. And then there's that new game, The Evil Within. And then I want to get the Wolfenstein new game. But I'll settle for a dinosaur documentary. Don't you believe it? Okay, next we have a film. This is actually a British television series that I have absolutely loved from the very first day that I saw it. I'm trying to collect all the films in this series. As a matter of fact, I'll have to show this out in my motion picture collection. I don't have a whole lot in this collection, but I absolutely love this character. And it's a show that's been around for 50 years and still going strong. But I started out, and this is a character that takes on many faces. Many actors have played him. But this actor has always been my introduction to the character, to the universe of this character, and he's always been my favorite of them all. And that's not to say that I don't like the rest, because I do like the rest in no uncertain terms, some better than the other ones, but this is always the one in my heart. This is Doctor Who, Terror of the Zygons. And that, of course, is the legendary Tom Baker. And this is actually one, guys, you know, Doctor Who, I saw this when I was a kid, this episode, Terror of the Zygons. I only seen it once, but it was actually kind of creepy when I first saw it. Now I imagine as I've grown up that it's probably nowhere near as creepy as I thought it was back then, but it was a really damn good episode. And what I remember about it the most are the Zygon creatures. You know, the older Doctor Who shows weren't really known for the best makeup. But the makeup on these creatures, if memory serves, was really, really great. They had some great makeup on this. And basically, everybody's heard of, I don't know if everybody, but the Loch Ness Monster. In this story, the Loch Ness Monster, we discover, is actually a robot created by the Zygons. So it kind of fills in the gaps as to, you know, what's behind the Loch Ness Monster and all that. But definitely love Doctor Who. Terror of the Zygons. Zygons. Even the word Zygon sounds cool. One thing about the new shows, guys, is that they've actually brought... The Zygons only appeared in one episode, but in the newer shows, and it may have been the 50th anniversary show, they brought the Zygons back. But they were nowhere near as threatening or as even scary as they were in the old days. I thought they were definitely deserving of a better story. They were just, you know, not even really essential to the story, in my opinion. They could have used any alien, but they definitely deserve their own story, a story that focuses just on them. Next, we have a double set of films. I have the first film. As a matter of fact, I only bought this because the second film was on it, and I did not have the second film, and I've never seen it. I got this from the pawn shop, too, guys, for only a buck. But this is the Lawnmower Man Collection, films number 1 and 2. I actually saw the Lawnmower Man original film in the theater, and I actually loved this film when I saw it in the theater. And I haven't seen it again since then, but this is that. Wasn't the Lawnmower Man a film by Stephen King, guys? Didn't he write this story, if memory serves? And if it was written by Stephen King, they are definitely not mentioning it on the case. But I believe The Lawnmower Man 2, wasn't that straight to video? Because it says PG-13, so I don't know. Maybe it was released in the theater. Anyway, that's definitely deserving of a review, the first one and then the second one, especially since I haven't seen the first one in forever. Okay, guys, we're on to some Blu-rays. And the first one is of a film that I've actually reviewed on my channel. I absolutely love this movie, guys. I just love this film. It's just great. I wouldn't recommend it to people who love CGI and not like practical. But, you know, this is a Japanese monster movie. And it's one of those films, like I said, I reviewed it on my site, so I'm not going to say too much about it, since I went kind of in-depth on the film before. But you can see every reason, you can hear every reason on my channel as to why I like this film. But I thought it was just a lot of fun. This is the kind of film that just, you know, stimulates a kid's imagination. I was a kid when I saw it. And, you know, ultimately, a lot of films that you liked as a kid that were a big part of your childhood are films that you just are very, very partial to. And this is a film that I'm very, very partial to. It's just a part of my childhood experience, and I've always loved the film and had a lot of fun with this movie. Just so colorful and fun, and it doesn't take itself too seriously. It's just a lot of fun. And it's one of those Toho films that I never get tired of watching, and I definitely say it was underrated. Check out my review of this movie, guys. This is King Kong Escapes. And I don't want to hear any, oh, you like that? A man in a fake suit instead of Godzilla 98? Well, what can I say, guys? My friend Rambo Raph said it best. Every film has a lover and every film has a hater. But anyway, but there's the back of it, guys. But I absolutely love this film, guys. I just think this film is just a blast, just a lot of fun. But I've always been, you know, the Japanese Godzilla films, the monster films go deeper than what I can really explain. But I will try to do that in my thoughts here for a minute. It's almost kind of like I said earlier, guys, how, you know, things are a part of your childhood experience. I actually saw the original Japanese monster films as a kid, and they're just a part of who I am. I just love those films. And they were such a huge part of my childhood that I just, you know, I'm attached to them. I cannot let them go. it's just films. It's all a funny thing, guys. Just a funny, funny kind of thing. How we balance the two things. How we love what we love, and sometimes we feel threatened by what's new, or we feel angry because someone has the audacity to make a remake of something that we love. But, you know, I always remain partial, guys. I'm not going to be the type to put anybody down for what they like. And it's really, really disheartening to me when you have people that will attack you for liking something that they don't like. And I pretty much credit it as anybody has a right to like or not like something. If someone hates a film that I love, so be it. I don't care. Their hatred for a movie is not going to diminish me. And I've said this a million and millions and millions of times. What I don't like is how people get all personal and attack someone for liking something that they don't like. That is, to me, a very, very immature individual that would actually take stabs and resort to trying to cut somebody down because they don't like something that they like. It's just totally childish. Ice machine. Totally childish, guys. And I hate when people personally attack other folks about things that they like. You know, I might not like the movie that you don't like. You might love a film and I might hate the film, but you can go through all my movies, guys, all my videos here on YouTube. There's not one instance where I'll call anybody a dumbass or you're dumb or, oh, you like that. I won't do it. I will not do it at all. I'm not going to attack people because, you know, I love people. And I'm not here to present a YouTube experience where I'm trying to make people feel any kind of negativity. If anything, I hope that my humble videos uplift your life. They bring you some kind of enjoyment, because it's not my goal to make people feel, you know, bad for anything that they like, and it's not my desire. And just putting it all out, guys, if I ever come across as someone that, you know, is hateful, spiteful, vengeful, it's definitely not intended, because I am not intending to be that way. I mean, there are times when I get frustrated with the entire YouTube experience. You know, some days you catch me and I might leave a comment that says, you know, sounds kind of rude, and it may actually have been intended to be rude, but I think you got to understand, you know, our experience, and I speak of fellow reviewers who are all nice people. All the people that I know that review films have been really, really nice to me. And, you know, but, you know, you might not realize it, guys. You guys that don't make videos, we take a pounding. We definitely take a pounding. And you got to have a thick skin, because, you know, you're called every name in the book. People will criticize you. People will cut you. They will call you the worst things in the world. They'll talk about your mother. They'll talk about your dad, your sister. I mean, everything except the goddamn movie. But anyway, you got to have a thick skin, guys. You got to not let it bother you. And you know, guys, I got to say it, you know, I've been called every racist name in the book. As a matter of fact, I still get that all the time. And you just gotta, you know, blow it off and say, you know, it's just words. It's just words. Because, you know, of the 5 or 10 negative comments you might get in a week, you've got all these other people that do appreciate what you do. And a lot of them aren't vocal. A lot of them don't leave comments or whatever. But you know they're there. And that's all that matters. Because I'm not going to allow the words of people that I don't even basically know, that are in other countries, that are sitting behind a keyboard, that are so miserable in their living existence that they want to try to bring me down. And I'm not going to allow them to bring me down, because I've got too much to be happy for. I've got too much to be thankful for. I've got some really, really great friends here on YouTube. I've made a fan film. It's always been a dream of mine to actually make a Star Trek fan film. And I've not only made that film, but it just turned out above expectations. The film's got almost 14,000 views since July. And it was so popular that we're actually working on the next one. So I'll be asking for money soon for donations to get this film made. I'm laughing, but it's true. But anyway, so, you know, I've got a lot to be happy about, guys. I mean, just, you know, there's too much. And it doesn't just go for me too. You guys, don't let the world's negativity in the world get you down, guys. You know, there's always something worth lifting your head up and giving out a smile, like my videos. I have brought happiness to many people. I'm a savior. But anyway, next film, guys, this is one I saw in the theater. Love this film. Amazingly, I don't have this film on DVD, but this is a film that I really enjoyed. I can't believe I didn't have it in my collection. Saw it in the theater, enjoyed it in the theater, and it's just one of those films that I think I really had a good experience with, even though it wasn't really much of a hit. And I think through time, it's kind of achieved a cult following, but I've always liked it. This is Ron Howard's Willow. And the Blu-ray to Willow, guys, I didn't even know this was on Blu-ray. Just happened to see it at Walmart, and it was only a measly $9.99. And it actually has this is actually a Blu-ray and a DVD, but it says Willow in high definition, Willow deleted scenes with Ron Howard, the making of an adventure with Ron Howard, from morph to morphing with Dennis Muren, Willow, an unlikely hero, personal video diary of Warwick Davis, and matte paintings. And just a lot of good features on this too, man, if you like this film. And I remember, you know, speaking of Willow, there was an NES game based on this film that I played so much. The doggone hardest game. I played it, I beat the game, and I played that game so many damn times I can still hear that theme playing in my head to the game. That's a lot of playing. A lot of playing. Okay, guys. Next Blu-ray is of a film by one of my all-time favorite actors. Love this actor to death. And if you want to know how much I love this actor, check out my Hammer Horror Film Reviews, because he is the star of many of those films. But this is called The Blood Beast Terror, starring Peter Cushing. And I just love Peter Cushing, guys. I undying respect for this actor. And like I said, check out my Hammer Horror Dracula Film Reviews, where you'll hear more insight into Peter Cushing, because I just love the actor. He's just wonderful. Never seen this film though, but I'm definitely going to watch it. And speaking of horror, guys, I'm taking a little diversion from the Friday the 13th and the Stephen King film reviews, but don't worry, I'm going to get back to those. Matter of fact, I'm not only going to do all the Friday the 13th films, which, as a matter of fact, I have actually watched Friday the 13th Part 3. Saw it last night, guys, as you can see. Yeah, saw the film. And it'll probably be my next video after this one. But the Stephen King films, I'm going to review quite a fit of those. Quite a few of those films. Maybe possibly mostly all of the Stephen King related film series. But next, guys, two more films left. This is one, I have the first film in this collection, and this is the sequel. I enjoyed the first film. The first film got a lot of hate from a lot of people, but ultimately in the end, I was entertained by the film. I wouldn't call it a great movie or anything like that, but it was a movie that I enjoyed. This actually came from 7-Eleven, and it's freaking dirty too. But this is Machete Kills. And I'm trying to think, was Mel Gibson in the first Machete or this one? Okay, he was in the first one. This one has an interesting cast, though, other than Danny Trejo. Michelle Rodriguez, who I really enjoy in films, even though, you know, in every movie she's playing the same character. But this one has Amber Heard, and I have not seen her in anything for a long time. Love this cover, though. This cover's pretty good, I gotta say. Love that cover. Here's the back of it. But yeah, I've seen the first and second film. As a matter of fact, I think there's a review up of the first film. It's been a long time. I think I reviewed it when it first came out. And I gave it a pretty good review. A lot of people did not like the first Machete film. But, you know, that's just another example of, you know, we have to agree to disagree and move on. I'm not going to call them any words or names because they didn't like the film. But, you know, I'm that kind of guy. I'm not out here to cause any kind of hate or anything. I'm really a kind, very kind person, guys. Very, very kind. And let me also mention, guys, my YouTube Facebook page is up. It's called MLKKAEF. You can find it on Facebook. And I'll even put a link down there to it here if you want to join the page. And lots of times I mention what's coming out before I actually release it in video form, so you'll have kind of a heads up on what's going on. But yeah, I'm a great guy. But anyway, next, guys, we have a film that once again came from 7-Eleven on Blu-ray, dirty as hell. And this is a film that I actually, you know, I reviewed this one too. It's up on my channel. I was a little bit disappointed with this movie. Maybe more than a little bit disappointed, but I was disappointed with the film ultimately. But I have all the other films. This is a franchise, and I had to have this one in my collection as well. And that movie is Riddick. And I'll show you the Blu-ray case here, guys. I was just wiping off the film itself because it's so dirty. It kind of just strikes me as weird that if you're going to sell movies or whatever, can't you at least clean them? Why are you giving me movies with fingerprints all on them? Okay, that's better. But there is Riddick, guys. Overall, overall, I liked the film, but at the same time, I was disappointed with it. I thought that it was basically a remake of the first one, minus all the action, adventure, charm, and tension of the original film. They didn't really do too good a job with this. And I remember in my review, I was disappointed because this was made by the same person that not only created the character, but had a hand in all the previous films. And I'm like, you know, if you can't depend on the creator of the character to make a good film and know the character, then who can you depend on? Matter of fact, where are the... Do I have the other ones on DVD or Blu-ray? Let's see. This is a Riddick, so where would it be? Maybe I don't, guys. Maybe I have it on Blu-ray or DVD only. Okay, I have this. And this Riddick says unrated director's cut. So I don't know what's new in it, but I don't think there's too much new in it because I haven't heard. But then I have Pitch Black with Vin Diesel. I thought I had the other one, which was up here, I believe, but I'm not for sure. But at any rate, guys, it's time to wrap it up. That was the last film in my collection today. That was my DVD and Blu-ray haul right here. And let me also say, guys, if you haven't checked out my Star Trek fan film, please feel free to do that as well. I'll put the link to that down at the bottom also. We are working on the second film. We're in pre-production right now. We're actually, you know, having costumes. Matter of fact, I'm pretty much, you know, doing it all myself. I'm having costumes made. I'm communicating with our CGI guy. We're making visual effects. Our director, Brady Foster, is actually rewriting the script now. And we got a lot of stuff going on, but like I'd mentioned kind of jokingly in this series, it is going to require funding. The first film we did all out of pocket. We didn't ask for anything, but I do believe we're going to run a fundraiser and try to raise some money to help with the cost of making this thing, because it's a much larger film than the first one's going to be, which was, the first one was just an introductory story. But if you haven't seen the first film, go watch it, please. And if you see any kind of value in it, think about a donation. We haven't started the fundraiser yet, but I mean, you'll hear about it when we do start it. I mean, if you want to donate to the film, $2, I mean, I don't care. Donate a dollar. There's no set limit. Anything you want to do to help out will be greatly, greatly appreciated. And I'm working out all the fundraising perks and all that, you know, but I appreciate any support you might be able to give us, guys. There's no way to donate now because the fundraiser isn't being ran yet, but I'll give you the details when we do. But anyway, guys, thanks for watching this DVD and Blu-ray update and listening to all my rambling on and on. And I appreciate you guys watching. Thanks, take care, and I will see you at the next video, which will be a discussion on my thoughts of Friday the 13th. Part 3D.